Welcome back to Paul's Tech News. From my understanding, you're here to be regaled with a succinct yet detail-laden synopsis of this week's PC hardware gossip. Scandalous stories of sin and slander, tales of new CPUs and GPUs launching with unimaginable power, and future prognostications of next-generation tech fast approaching on the horizon. Well, nothing like that actually happened this week, sorry, but I'll carry on nonetheless. Let's see, we have a predictably impractical and mostly dumb new CPU from Intel, water cooling radiators with lead in them, cryptocurrency mining is back, yay, this time on CPUs, and yet another beloved video game franchise sucks now thanks to a piss-poor remaster that was rushed out to capitalize on gamers' nostalgia. It's a good thing spring is officially starting this week, because maybe what we should all really do is just go outside and take an internet break. After this episode of Tech News.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by the Tower 300 series cases from Thermaltake, expanding their vertical tower design with a stunning new lineup available in a variety of colors. The larger frame now supports micro ATX motherboards as well as huge GPUs, including the RTX 4090, without compromising airflow thanks to an abundance of filtered ventilation panels. Two CT140 fans come pre-installed, and the right side can house up to 420mm AIO radiators. Finish your build off with a sold separately 3.9-inch LCD panel kit, or even go horizontal with a matching chassis stand for a truly unique look. For more on Thermaltake's The Tower 300 series cases, click the sponsor link in the video description. A grand finale is usually a noteworthy event, a barrage of fireworks, a last hurrah, perhaps one last round of whatever it was that made the thing being grandly finalized so great. But for Intel's 14900KS, the presumptive last and final CPU to be made commercially available on their current platform, LGA 1700, the end is a lot more bitter than it is sweet. And it's no surprise either, as this was also the case with the 13900KS and the 12900KS that preceded it. Binned silicon can only go so far, and an impressive advertised peak clock speed becomes far less impressive when thermals, power draw, and a $140 price increase are factored in. Reviews that went live Thursday were quick to point out that the $690 14900KS still regularly hits 100 degrees Celsius, even with a top-end 360mm all-in-one liquid cooler, and that two-core 6.2 GHz thermal velocity boost frequency only applies if the CPU is below 70 degrees Celsius. The KS has a new extreme power profile that bumps the power limit to 320 watts, a pretty steep jump from the 14900K's 253 watt limit given the marginal performance boost, and marginal it was indeed, as exemplified in a variety of Tom's Hardware's benchmarks results, such as the Blender Monster test, where the 14900KS used 31% more power than the 14900K for less than 1% better performance. That definitely sounds like it's worth an extra 140 bucks. The only arguable practical use case for these CPUs is extreme overclocking, and I am sure there's a handful of hardware bot leaderboard aspirants who are keen to get their hands on a 14900KS, like Swedish overclocker Elmore, who broke 4 world records with the chip as of Friday, including the peak frequency record at 9117.75 MHz, as well as new high marks in PiFast, SuperPi, and PiPrime. And it was just Pi Day this past week, so I guess that is pretty sweet after all. Speaking of computer stuff, cryptocurrency mining isn't something PC builders have needed to worry much about since late 2022 when Ethereum switched to proof of stake and the floor dropped out from under the GPU mining market. But crypto has been on a bull run lately, led by Bitcoin of course, which recently hit an all-time high just shy of $74,000. And while Bitcoin is impractical to mine on non-ASIC hardware, and Ethereum just isn't mineable period, there are still plenty of other cryptocurrencies that still use shitty old-fashioned proof of work for their model, so PC hardware is apparently being scooped up for this very purpose once again. The twist is, this time they're after CPUs, specifically the AMD Ryzen 7950X, which can earn about $3 a day right now if you're mining Cubic, a digital currency that leverages the AVX 512 instruction set for mining, which AMD's Zen 4 CPUs totally support. That's factoring power usage in too, which is also benefited by AMD's highly efficient 5nm processors, especially when underclocked. Even an RTX 4090 will top out at less than $2 a day in the current market, so it's somewhat understandable that a much less expensive CPU would be preferred. Now, you'd still need more than 6 months to recoup the cost of a 7950X, which watch is about $550 to $560 right now, so there's still a lot of risk given the highly volatile crypto market. Case in point, in the time it took me to write this segment, Bitcoin dropped in price by about $2,000. And then again, in the time it took me to come in here and film it, it raised in price again by another $1,000. Which is probably why the 7950X isn't completely sold out. There are none available directly from Newegg, but you can still add to cart from quite a few other retailers, although stock does appear to be running out. Speaking of dumb computer stuff, liquid cooling. I'm just kidding. Some liquid cooling solutions, not all of them, but some of them, really suck. And no, I'm not on an anti-water cooling crusade recently, this is purely coincidence. Igor of IgorsLab has recently published a series of radiator teardowns, specifically to confirm whether many units are built the way they say they are built. By using copper, for example, which is both better at cooling and more expensive to source as a material solution for radiator channels and fins. In the first installment, it was revealed that a handful of units from the six manufacturers tested were using brass channels instead of copper, which wasn't ideal. But this week they added four more, and one finding resulted in an immediate halt of all sales in Europe. It seems that the Barrow Debacle 28B Slim 120mm radiator contains way too much lead in its solder, 70% or so, which is an ROHS violating amount of lead, and if you know anything about lead, you hopefully know that it is extremely toxic and especially dangerous for children. Fortunately, Barrow's distributor Case King immediately withdrew all Barrow Dabble radiator products from sale and will be accepting customer returns regardless of the date of purchase and the purchase price. But for anyone who is trying to save some money by buying PC parts from questionable brands with fire sale prices, consider that the trade-off might not just be products with a higher rate of failure, it could also mean the use of banned or toxic materials. Check your rads, everyone, and get the lead out. Speaking of getting the lead out, we're in the tech news home stretch now, so let's speed through these tech briefs. Star Wars Battlefront and Battlefront 2 launched in 2004 and 2005, and people quite liked them, so re-releasing a restored version of both titles across multiple platforms, including for PC via Steam, seemed like a good idea, but developer Aspyr seems to have fucked the whole thing up in multiple ways. For instance, despite about 10,000 players excitedly loading the game up on Thursday, they had just 3 64-player servers ready to go. 192 slots, which meant they were roughly 10,000 slots short. Bugs and glitches abounded as there were two disparate builds of the game in the wild with no way to choose between them, and the game inexplicably takes up 60 to 70 gigabytes of space on the PC, which has led many to accuse Aspyr of lazy development and a sore lack of optimizations. But don't worry guys, the backlash and horrendously negative reviews were enough to prompt Aspyr to say, "We're sorry. We experienced critical errors with our network infrastructure. The result was incredibly high ping, matchmaking errors, crashes, and servers not appearing in the browser. So we should all forgive them, immediately." What, did you expect them to have their video game ready to play on its launch day? I mean, the games are only like 20 years old. Next, we have another rumor that has oozed forth about the RTX 50 series. "It shall use 512-bit GDDR7 memory," claims Copite 7 Kimi. Unless it's 384-bit, which Copite 7 Kimi claimed last week. But probably, almost definitely, fingers crossed, 512-bit GDDR7. It'll be 28 gigabits per second GDDR7, a nice bump up from the current gen GDDR6X that tops out at 23 gigabits per second, while still leaving some headroom for faster 32 gigabits per second GDDR7 that has appeared in spec sheets, but might not be widely available earlier in the product development cycle. Further information about the RTX 50 series is classified, and if I were to share it with you, you would have to claw your eyes out and cut your tongue off afterwards, so I'm not going to tell you. You're welcome. I've pretty much saved all of your lives just now. Speaking of life-saving information, I have a dire warning for Steam Deck OLED owners. Your screen might be susceptible to burning. I know, it is a terrible thing. Even after as little as 1,000 to 1,500 hours of use, some Steam Deck OLED owners who play at higher brightness levels have reported the telltale ghosts that indicate burned-in LED pixels, with YouTubers Wolf Den and The Fox, no relation, publishing scandalous exposés on the subject. And it's a good reminder that most all OLED screens require a bit of extra attention, a massage here and there, perhaps a small gift, or even just a sincere compliment can really make their day. The best solution here, though, would be for Steam to push a Steam Deck update that allowed users to enable regular screen health passes or basic solutions like pixel shifting, or just be like me and use a shitty old non-OLED Steam Deck. Really slumming it, I know, but gets me by. And I hope this video gets you by as well. There you have it, guys, tech news for the week. And if you liked it, click that like button or leave me a comment down below. While you're down there, all the articles I talked about today are linked in the video's description if you're interested. And you can check out my store at paulshardware.net for high quality merchandise, t-shirts, hoodies, beer sets, and more. Subscribing to my channel is always a good call too. Thanks again, everyone, and we'll see you next week.